be cheerful. They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if any among you wander from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's souls from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in heart, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please join in singing hymn numbers 170.
Oh,
Almighty God, through the waters of baptism, your Son has made us children of light. May we ever walk in his light and show forth your glory in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely his anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was a ruddy and handsome lad and had beautiful eyes. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Serve you.
It was so, and all things came into being. from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Once you were darkness, but now in the world you are light. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness. Rather, expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. The word of the Lord.
Sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, but it is someone like him. He kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. And they brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner perform such signs? And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened. He said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age, ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? Then they reviled him, saying, you are his disciples, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born entirely in sins, and are they trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshipped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees heard him say this and said to him, surely we are not blind, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, we see, your sin remains. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Famous hymn, Amazing Grace. I think the last two lines are so powerful. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but now I see. And see as in seeing with our eyes, and also seeing as understanding, as when we say, oh, I see what you mean. Today's story plays with both these ways of seeing in order to teach us what it means for us to really see, to know the truth of who we are in God and what we're here to do. We begin with Jesus doing the seeing. He sees a man blind from birth, restores his sight, and just think how that totally changes everything for that man. For the first time in his life, he can see. Faces, sunsets, flowers, his own parents. Can you imagine the wonder and the joy? And now he doesn't have to beg anymore, to know himself as someone helpless or useless or unwanted. Not anymore. Just the sheer possibilities of what he might do and where he might go are endless. Yes, his encounter with Jesus has given him a whole new life. And more than that, over the course of the story, he comes to see something else, that in Jesus, he has actually seen God. God is clearly doing this incredible new thing in Jesus. The man sees that too, and so he falls down in worship. God has reached out to him. The man who, once blind from birth, and maybe blind to God in his life, now also sees the truth of who he is. Not a nobody, not wrong or unwanted, but somebody who matters, somebody who is loved and blessed. Henceforth, all his days, this man will know his life to be a miracle, an amazing grace indeed. And at the end of the story, Jesus says of him that this is why I have come, that those who are blind may see the truth of themselves in God, loved by God. Well, that's wonderful, but meanwhile, all of this quickly brings the Pharisees on the scene. And after that, most of our gospel story is taken up with them. Pharisees, of course, tend to be the villains of the New Testament. We might think of them simply as people who are convinced they know the truth about God, and therefore about pretty much everything. After all, they're the acknowledged experts on the law that God gave to Moses. That's made the Pharisees quite certain they know everything God intends. They know the mind of God. Wow. That they might just be wrong about that, or that God might be actually doing something new, something they didn't expect, just doesn't enter into the Pharisees' thinking. Besides, it's clear to them from their reading of Scripture that no prophet, let alone the Messiah, was expected to come from, well, from Galilee of all places. So the Pharisees decide that somebody claiming to have been healed by this Jesus of Nazareth has to be either a fool or a liar. On that basis, they proceed to interrogate the man. They ridicule and bully him and his parents. Treating them badly doesn't bother the Pharisees, because to them it's not actual people who count so much as their idea of the law, which all people must obey. But they get nowhere. The man knows what he knows. I was blind, but now I see. And it was Jesus who did it. The Pharisees refuse to see that, even though the proof is standing there right in front of them, looking back at them. Finally, Jesus says to the Pharisees, "This is also why I have come, so that those who are so sure they do see, like you Pharisees, may be revealed as blind." Moreover, says Jesus, in what is the very last line of our story, know this, when you insist that you do see, that you do know when you really don't, that, he says, is sin. And moreover, your sin remains. Now, sin is not a popular word in the world today. There's guilt and shame associated to that with that word that none of us like to feel. But what about sin that remains, that doesn't ever go away, that stays with you, that kind of sticks to you? That sounds really bad. And it is, because this is a warning. Jesus is saying that if we, like the Pharisees, are tempted to insist that, oh yeah, we see, in the sense of, we know, we've got the truth all sewn up, then we actually will get it wrong. Really wrong. both with other people and with God. Why? Because pretending to a perfect knowledge, a complete understanding that we don't and we can't have, only leads us to relate to others in ways that are distorted and unloving. Others will become to us less like persons and more like objects that must either fit into our preset system of beliefs or be rejected. And as long as we think and act on that basis, says Jesus, the sin remains, at least until we have the grace to change how we're operating. And so how do we do that? How do we keep ourselves free from those fixed assumptions, those preset judgments that get us into trouble? Well, compared to the Pharisees, perhaps we might start with a different kind of emotional orientation to life. And that thought puts me in mind of one of my favorite authors. I've always wanted to use her in a sermon. A Canadian, Louise Penny. Yeah. Her series of Inspector Gamache murder mysteries are perennial bestsellers. I think it's in a TV series now, isn't it? Now, I realize that crime novels are not exactly where you might expect to find guidance like this, but I think maybe it's worth a look. She has her main character, Inspector Gamache, share this same piece of wisdom with someone, usually a new young recruit, a young police officer, in almost every single book she writes. It's clearly very significant for Louise Penny, and perhaps it should be for us as well. Here's a short quote from her very first novel. "There are four things that lead to wisdom," Gamache said. "You ready for them?" The young woman nodded, wondering when the actual police work would begin. "They are four sentences we learn to say and mean." Gamache held up his hand as a fist and raised a finger with each point. "They are, I don't know. I need help. I'm sorry. I was wrong." Now, those four sentences aren't always easy for any of us to say, and mean. But it's hard to imagine the Pharisees ever saying or meaning any of them. The common theme in being able to say, "I don't know. I need help. I'm sorry, I was wrong," is humility. We call it being real. A commitment we have as followers of Jesus, always to be as open and honest and present to our neighbors as we can, because otherwise we're not able to love them as we're commanded. Which brings us to the next step. Okay, we practice humility, being real. But what should guide our actions? Well, let's go back to the beginning of our gospel story and hear again what Jesus says, because it's actually pretty astonishing. Remember when he and the disciples first come across the blind man? Notice something. Notice that the disciples don't greet the man. They don't touch him. They don't go near him. Instead, they just talk about him. He's like an object for discussion before moving on. They wonder, who's at fault here? Who sinned, the man or his parents, that he was born blind? That was a common belief in those days, that if somebody had some kind of affliction, then they must have done something bad to deserve it. And note the unspoken corollary. Since it's their fault, it's not my problem. So the disciples engage in a little Pharisaical type thinking and of their own. According to what we know of such things, who's to be judged here? Who should we condemn? But Jesus turns around, looks at them, and says, "Nobody. Nobody sinned. There's nobody to blame here." Now hear what Jesus says next. The man was born blind so that God's works could be revealed in him. Think about that. Anybody suffering, and since we all suffer in some way, that's all of us, is to be seen as an opportunity for God's works to be revealed. And what works are those? Well, as the healing of the blind man showed, they're the works of love. Love that gives life and life in abundance. Whether it's healing or helping or visiting, consoling, guiding, befriending, or something else. And who is to do these works that serve to bring more life, more hope and joy into the world? In the story, it's Jesus who does it. He heals the blind man. But, and here's the astonishing part, Jesus says, we, meaning you and I, we must work the works of him who sent me. So we in Jesus, in the one who is the light of the world, we are to do the works of God, the works of love. That's our gift and our calling. That's why we're here, each one of us. Try saying that to yourself every morning when you rise. I am here today, just as I am, to do the works of God, the works of love. In humility and openness of spirit, walking with God, I am here to bring more of life into this world, one heart at a time. For that's our mission, because it's God's mission. I think it's our one shot at building a real future for us all on this earth. And when we can see that, when we can see the blessings and the joy that come from that, how it changes everything, us and everything, then we can truly say of ourselves, was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
life-giving God. You put out the welcome mat for us. You nourish our souls and bodies through your goodness and tender mercies. You heal our life's wounds, and your generous love fills us to overflowing. You give us an honored place at your table, and invite us to stay with you as your guest forever. You have promised that your unfailing love will stay with us always, and for this we give you our thanks as we pray, Shepherding God, hear our prayer. Shepherding God,
hear our prayer.
Gracious and good God, open the eyes of your church and fill us with the vision of Christ. In the worldwide Anglican cycle, we pray for the Anglican Church of South Africa and for the Right Reverend Dr. Thabo Mbeki, Archbishop of Cape Town and Primate of South Africa. In the Council of the North, we pray for Bishop Jane Alexander and the Territory of the People, that we may work the works of God while it is day, bringing light and hope to all the world. Shepherding God, merciful Father, through your holy baptism, you grant us the forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit, who grants us spiritual sight. In this week's Anglican Lutheran prayer cycle, we pray for the Right Reverend Mary Owen Gibson Bishop and the people and the clergy of the Diocese of Montreal, the assistant to the bishop and the staff of the Manitoba Northwestern Ontario Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church. As we pray for the elimination of racial discrimination, forgive the blindness that causes our eyes to notice and magnify those things we regard as different from ourselves and others. Teach us to see clearly that we, your children, are far more alive than we are different. Help us to put aside the racial prejudices embedded within us and to see within every person the child of God you created, our sister or brother, destined for glory. Shepherding God, gracious Lord and Father, you are the light and the salvation of your people. Since you have called us to be your own shining city on a hill, bright with the light of Christ, as we ask you to graciously bless Bishop Todd and Archdeacon Megan, and in the Deanery of Delaware, Trinity Hill, St. John's in Glencoe, St. Andrew's Munsey, and Zion Anita. In our own parish, we pray for your blessing on Reverend Matt, our pastor, for Reverend Jerry, and for Karen and Wendy, our honorary assistant, for Reverend Kay, our deacon, and for this holy gathering. Empower us by your Spirit to reflect the light of your love to all people in what we say or do. Shepherding God, help us to find out what is pleasing to you as we offer to you our sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving, especially for Dorothy Hobbs and Gary Cole on a parish cycle of prayer this week. Shepherding God, Almighty One, anoint for us those whom you would call to leadership, and let your divine Spirit come mightily upon them, that all who hold power and authority in the world may take no part in unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them to the light. Shepherding God, eternal wisdom, revive our souls and guide us along right pathways for the sake of your name, as we seek to serve you among our neighbors in this community, that none may be scapegoated or blamed for our own blindness, as we move from darkness to light, discovering the fruit of the Spirit in all that is good and right and true. Shepherding God, loving God, let your compassion reach out in mercy toward all who are oppressed by injustice, violence, poverty, economic distress, illness, or natural disasters throughout the world. May your goodness and mercy comfort and relieve them, and your strong rod and staff empower them. Shepherding God, great physician, we pray that you would grant healing to all those who suffer from any affliction of body or soul, remembering especially Yvonne and Joe, Sue and Peter, Marilyn, Iris, Nevin, Noah, Rebecca, Cindy, Kathy, Judy, Brandon, Al, Bernice, Len, Josh, Tom, Liz, Michael, Janet, Bill, Doug, Ian, George, Jason, Wendy, Mike, and any others you may care to mention either silently or aloud. Shine upon them with your mercy, according to your good will and gracious will, and continually remind them of your love and care for them. Shepherding God. Though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil, for you are with us. We try and trust your shepherding arms those who have died. May they dwell in the house of God forever. Shepherding God, lifting our voices with all creation, with St. Andrew and all the saints, let us offer ourselves and one another to the living God through Christ. To you, Lord. Open our eyes to see your intimate presence in the world about us, that we may awaken and live in your light, to lie down in green pastures and be led beside still waters, all for your love's sake, through Jesus Christ, your anointed, in the power of the Holy Spirit. For you live and reign one God forevermore.
Amen. Please stand as you're able. My brothers and sisters in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Yes. strive to give all my thanks and praise.
Worship and praise belong to you, Father, in every place and at all times. You meet us, all people of the world, and everything that is. You give us daylight. Your word lights up our minds. Jesus was born among us in the light of our darkness. Your spirit lives in us so that we can look through at the world with your eyes. One day we will be with you in heaven, but already we laugh with the saints and angels and sing their joyful song.
Holy, 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 holy.
Jesus, who gave his life for us. He healed those who were sick, cared for those who were poor, and cried with those who were sad. He forgave sinners and taught us to forgive. For all your love, we give you thanks in the way that Jesus showed us. In the night before he died, while having supper with his friends, he took bread and offered you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to him, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body. It is broken for you." He took the bread and offered you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to him, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you." After supper, he took the cup. He offered you thanks, and he gave it to him, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for all, that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." So we do what he told us. We open our hearts to him. We remember how he died and rose again to live in us now. Together with him, we offer you these gifts. In them, we give you ourselves. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on this bread and this wine, that they may be the body and blood of Christ, and that sharing your life, we may travel in your company to our journey's end. With all your people, we give you thanks and praise through the Son and in the Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let your church be the wheat which bears its fruit in dying.
If we do not die with him, we shall live with him. If we hold firm, we shall reign with him.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
May we always have faith in him, Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God. May the God of mercy transform you by his grace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
And I believe we have some announcements from John.
Whichever you can find. You may have noticed the notice of a fundraising meal for early recovery efforts in Syria and Turkey. The event is this evening, and you can reserve a spot on the website listed on the back of the book. Next week, we'll be welcoming Chris Morton, a street outreach worker downtown, to speak during the sermon time. We've been collecting warm winter items and granola bars for him to distribute over the last month or so. You're engaged to bring in some more of these items that we present to him. And thank you for your ongoing support of our food cover grocery ministry. Our supplies are starting to deplete somewhat, so please remember that you can bring in the suggested or non-perishable donations on Sundays and put them in the wooden boxes by the coat racks. Lastly, a reminder for Sunday school teachers that there will be a meeting downstairs immediately after the service to discuss roles and planning. And our last hymn is 446.